Hey, welcome everyone. We starting in a couple of minutes. Sorry for a delay. We're just waiting until people get some food. I would say you still have time to get a cup of coffee or tea and get back to us in approximately 8 to 10 minutes. So see you around.
So the stream is going on.
Okay. I'll just say then a couple of words and then we continue, right?
Yeah. We just wait till everyone sits and then we will start.
Yeah, great. The people see this part. Yeah. Yeah. Because I shut down everything in my laptop to make sure that it's great.
Perfect.
Good. Okay. Then I'm saying to people that you start and then this one's going on.
It's maybe nice to move to this table. Now you're a bit behind. I will stand. Yeah? Okay.
I will be with you for 1 minute and then I will leave you on the floor.
Yeah, you want to start saying something?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just want to say something to.
Yeah.
Is it unmuted, right?
It is unmuted.
Yeah. Okay. So, welcome everyone to our first in this year meetup with our beautiful speaker. Inke van den Ende. Today meetup is dedicated to informal prediction, so which is a really interesting topic for those who are working with forecast. So without further ado, I'm going to give a space to Inge. With one thing, we also streaming this event, so the record will be available on YouTube. So those who are with us online, if you have any questions, you can ask them in our YouTube chat, and if we have time, we're going to answer that. For the rest, floor is yours, Inge. So, good luck.
Thank you very much. And thanks everyone for coming. Super good to see you. I hope you're going to enjoy the topic of conformal prediction. So, I'm Inge. I work as a data scientist here at Dexter Energy. At Dexter, we forecast renewable energy and we optimize it as well. I will explain a little bit on the next slides what why that's necessary. And since you're all here now, we can also take a little bit of your time. We're hiring, so if you're interested, there's papers on the back, and you can ask everyone at Dexter about how it is to work here as machine learning engineer or data scientist. We're growing quite a bit. I work here now for 3 years, and I started when there were 10 people, and now we're 80, so it's quite different company already in 3 years. I had some practical things. If you want to leave during the workshop, there's an exit over there, because you came in on that side, but there's also in the lobby, there's also alarm. So if you accidentally step outside of the route from our office to the main door, you will trigger an alarm. So it's nicer to use the exit over there, then you're safe without alarm. And there is also toilets there if you want to use them. And if you have any questions or looking for anything, you can ask me, but anyone that works at Dexter, feel free to ask anything. So let's start a little bit with the energy market and then go into the data science stuff. So why do we need to forecast actually on the energy market? And especially we're going to talk today about conformal prediction, which is about quantifying the uncertainty of your forecast, and why is that important? So a thing that's very important to know is that on the electricity grid, supply and demand always need to be in balance. So here, if you just wanted to grab a cup of tea and you turn on the heater, you take out energy to the grid. That means that at that exact same moment in time, somewhere on the electricity grid, that same amount of energy has to go in. For example, generated by a wind turbine. But it's quite difficult to keep that in balance all the time, because it's all the time it has to be balanced. And the demand, you don't know exactly when everyone in the Netherlands is going to drink a cup of tea or plug in their laptop. And the supply, it used to be a bit more easy, because gas and coal you can set, so you can decide how much energy you're going to produce tomorrow. But for wind and solar energy, you don't know. Maybe there's going to be a cloud in 5 minutes from now, or maybe especially tomorrow, do we know exactly how much wind or solar there will be. So it makes it very difficult to balance things, which you both are very uncertain about. And it also becomes more difficult over time, because we get more wind turbines, we get more solar energy. What we are at Dexter, we're very happy about it, but it makes it more challenging, because how are you going to match things that you both are very uncertain about? So something you can do to be better in preparing for that is to have an insight in the uncertainty, so that you know how uncertain you are, so you can make better decisions beforehand. And you can do that when you forecast the supply. So for example, for a wind turbine, how much does a wind turbine generate, or solar panel? So that's something we do at Dexter. But you can do the same for the demand, or for the combination of the two of them, which is actually captured in the price. So the price is always the match between supply and demand. So that's what we try to do. And that's also why we're very interested in knowing more about the uncertainty of our forecast. But which is not so nice is that most of the models people use for regression problems, they are a point forecast. So they give you one moment in time. They don't give you any information about this uncertainty. So if you look at this slide, here on the horizontal axis, you see time, and then on the vertical axis, it's the value you're forecasting. So on the previous slide, it could have been the generation of energy by wind turbine, for example. But it can also be any case that you're currently working on. The methods I'm going to present, you can use it for any model that you're using. So what our machine learning model does is it looks at the past. It checks out what is the observations we have seen so far, and it gives you predictions for the future. So it thinks it most likely is going to be that value if you make a prediction. But quite likely, it's not going to be exactly that value. So how do we add some information about this uncertainty? A simple step to take is to add a prediction interval. So you have one interval that gives you information about how much of the points do you expect within those two lines. So instead of only giving one line and you think it's going to be somewhere around here, you give the same line, but also interval. If you, for example, say, within 90% certainty, I expect the point to be between these boundaries. And that's something that
conformal prediction can very easily do for us. So in this presentation, I will first explain a little bit with the presentation. Then you can work in Jupyter Notebooks in Python. Then there's going to be a second part, and also again with some Python for you. And the first part will be about this. How can you use conformal prediction to add a prediction interval to your forecast? So how does it work? The nice thing about conformal prediction is that you can use any model that you are already using. So it's really something you can add on top of the project you're doing right now. And for that, you need to split your data set one more time than you usually do. So let's say you usually use a train and a test set. Of course, there's also other options, but keep it a bit basic for now. So we have a train and a test set. Now for conformal prediction, we do a train set, a calibration set, and a test set. So the calibration set will be used to determine that prediction interval. And that's also the steps that you're going through. So we have a step of training, a step of calibration, and a step of prediction that I will discuss one by one. So, should click one more time. So first, okay. Can everyone still see the slide? I think it's, if there's something here you want to see, just call me and I'm going to go there. First, you train your machine learning model, and this doesn't change anything. So this is just maybe today you trained the model and you can still use the same model, only you have to use the specific train set without the calibration set. So it can be regression, you can have deep learning models, you can have tree-based models, that's fine. You can also do the same, also do conformal prediction for classification, but that I don't discuss today. So then in the second step, that's the additional step, you're going to use your trained model to predict the calibration set. So instead of directly going to your test set and giving your prediction, you first do that thing for your calibration set, and you're going to look at the difference between your prediction and the actual values. So the residuals, the difference between the prediction and the actual value that you have in your data set, that are all combined are called your conformity scores. So that's very important to keep in mind, because then you know how far am I spread around this forecast that I'm making. So how wide does the interval has to be that I'm making my prediction within. So if you create a list of all those scores, you can select the quantile and get a certain number to determine the width of this interval. So also make this visually a bit more how it is in Python actually. Let's click through. So you predict for your calibration set, then for every point you're going to look at the difference between the actual and the prediction. You list your absolute values, so it doesn't matter where it's higher or lower, and then you select the right quantile. So if you, for example, want to look at the 40% interval, it will be more narrow, and if you want to look at the 90% interval, it's wider, and you can do that either with the quantile function, or you can use just a way to compute the index that you want to select. So in this formula that I listed here, you have one minus your confidence, so alpha is, for example, your 90% confidence that you want to have in your interval, then times the length of the list, and minus one, because we're in Python and we start counting at zero. So then you have one number, and that's gonna be the width of your interval. So then you take that number to the next step, you make the prediction for your test set, and you can add the interval. So this first part that I'm showing here, it's exactly the same, so it didn't change at all. So it's just using the same model that you usually use. You just add something on top of it. So you add the number that you just selected, the correction factor in the previous slide, and you subtract it to get a boundary around your forecast. As you can see, it's constant for the whole prediction set that you make. It's still quite a simple method, but it's nice thing about it is that it's always correct, because you really base it on your data. So it will always be matching the distribution of your data. You don't need to make any assumptions on distribution or anything. So I will go into those advantages and disadvantages a little bit more after we did the workshop, but I thought it might be nice to first start and have a look at it. So two very well-known packages are MAPI and Krebs. So that's are two that personally I like to use. So I created a notebook for you. First part of it computes it manually. So really that you do it step by step. So you, because MAPI and the Krebs package both are quite set up how you know your machine learning model. So it's just like a fit predict. So you don't see that much about what is happening behind it. So first we're going to compute it ourselves. That's also the part where you can, I made in the workshop file some empty lines. So you have to fill in your own code. Then after that, there's a part about comparing the two. And there are also, I didn't add assignments that you have to fill them in because it's quite straightforward. It's really just a fit and predict. But feel free to play around, add some other options. There's quite some options, especially for the MAPI package. So if you have quite simple problems, I personally really like the Krebs package because it's very easy if you want to dive into the code. It's quite easy to read. It's also a lot faster. But the MAPI package is more extensive. So it's a very a big amount of documentation, very big amount of different methods. For example, using cross-validation for your calibration set and those kind of things. So if you want to use it and you want to keep it quite basic, I would always recommend Krebs. But if you want to do more extensive things, it's good to go for MAPI. So now you all can get your laptop. I added here also a QR code that goes to the repository. So just Jupyter Notebooks in a repository, also the requirements file is there. And you can open the first workshop file. So now it's really about the first file. I don't know. That I never tried. Yeah, so you have around 10 minutes to have a look, and then we also discuss it together a bit more.
that we've shared right now.
Mute. Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Great.
And just so, to make sure that you unmute.
Yeah, I'm
unmute.
So everyone, I will now go through it as well. I hope everyone found everything, and I saw a lot of people writing code, so that's super good. I will start with the workshop file, but I will go in between the workshop and the solution file and just mention what is the difference. Then you can also have a look later at the exact same code. So we start just with the input, but there I already made part of the workshop, because here the big difference would normally is that you normally make a train and test set, and now you also make a calibration set. So if you go to the solutions file, it's a little bit bigger if I do this, you see that you just do that by repeating the same function. So train, test, split, functions quite commonly used to train, to split your data set. You just repeat it, but then with part of the data. So you first start with your whole data set, which is called X and Y. And I made a test set of 50%, quite big, but you can decide that for yourself. And then again, on the train set, you do the same thing. So you split it in a train set that you can use to train your model still. And then 25% you have as a calibration set. And then later on, if you train your model, you have to be careful that you use the, in this code, it's called prop train, so that you don't use the full set for training your model. If anyone has questions, by the way, feel free to ask it now. We just go through it. So if you have a question, yeah?
I have a question. The value of the interval has some dependence on the way you split the train as the train, the way you partition the train. So to mitigate this effect, what do you do? Something like a cross-validation. You loop over the whole interval several times and you find some sort of statistics.
Yeah, so the usual way is to do a cross-validation, but it's also, so in Dexter here, we work a lot with time series, so it makes it a bit difficult to use cross-validation because you don't want to throw around data points that are from the future. So there's also, then again, specific ways that just bootstrap, so they just take one extra one and then it shifts. In the app, I also have a link to that if you specifically want to know about time series. But for this case, I try to keep it as simple as possible. So you just randomly select your set.
Thanks.
And the next question asked in the workshop was to choose your own confidence. So in the solutions file, I use 90%. But you can do the same thing, run exactly the same code if you give it a different confidence. So now we get, I think, at the most interesting part, and that's actually to compute it ourselves for one time to understand what happens. And you can see here that here in the introduction, I already fitted my baseline model. I did it on purpose outside of the conformal prediction, because this is what you normally always do. So this is not affected by this method. The only thing you really need to keep in mind is that you use the prop train and not your full train set. So you use your model that was already fitted, and you can use that to predict your calibration set. So then we're going to look at the conformity scores, which is actually the residuals. So it will be the difference between your prediction and the actual value. And because we take the absolute value after that, it doesn't even matter or you do it one direction or the other. So here in the solution file, I just do the actuals, y call, minus my point prediction for the calibration set, and take the absolute value of them and sort them. So then I get this list that I also illustrated here. Go back here. So now you have your list, and that's basically set up to make any prediction interval. So the same list, you can select the confidence that you want. So now in the solution file, I will select 90%. So I take the index that corresponds to 90%. But I can use the same list and take, for example, 20%. So it can also be that in your case, you want to look at multiple. So then you just repeat the same thing and you just get kind of a estimation of a distribution because you have multiple prediction intervals for different certainties. So here you could also use the function mpquanta. Wait, let me run the code for a little bit. Yeah, I think so. Why doesn't it zoom? Wait, I have a mouse here. Let me grab it and I think it can zoom. So this correction factor index really gives me a specific index for the list. That's why I also computed it here myself, because then you really select one of the numbers you just found in the residuals. So it does 1 minus 90%, because we go from high to low. If you would sort your list the different way around, you could also do it just with the confidence. And then you do the times the length of the list minus 1. And that will give you the correction factor, so actually the residual that you found here as well. You could also use a function like, for example, mpquanta. And then you can just give it the list and say, like, I want this percentage, and it will do the same thing. But then you have to be careful that you always indeed do 1 minus your confidence or sort your list the other way. So what we then basically do is we have this one number and we just subtract it and sum it with the prediction we have. And then we get, let me show here. Point prediction first. So usually you just have your array for every point you have one prediction. And now the prediction interval, I just made it the two, just gave it 2 columns. So now we know for the first prediction, it was 479,000, and we think it's with 90% certainty between 330 and 627. So it's quite a wide range, but it's also because we have quite a high confidence level. So if you do, for example, 10%, that will be a lot closer together. And you can also see that I now plotted it like it's a time series. In this use case, it's actually not exactly, but that you can see that it's just a fixed interval around it. So it doesn't depend on the point that it's like wider or more narrow, but it's just one fixed interval because we just summed it and subtracted it here. So it's just constant over the whole prediction set. Did people actually get to this part? No? Okay. Then I will just show the other part as well. And maybe later, if you want to explore it more at home or anything, feel free to do that and also reach out to me if you have specific questions. So then the next part, I will then go to this because people didn't see. The next part actually compares the different packages. So here I started the CAPS package and I also time it to check that it's faster than the other one. So you see it's very, the same setup as you usually would recognize. So here you have fit and calibrate and predict. So instead of just a model that has fit and predict, you now fit, calibrate, predict, and then you can also predict interval, which gives you the interval that we just computed. And you just need to wrap a regressor around your model. And you can also do that freely before and after it's being trained. So you can Now, let's see. Now I did it just with the baseline model and I trained it on the prop train set, but I could also train my baseline model, then wrap it and then continue. Then this part does the basic settings of MAPI. So it also answers your question. So in the default settings, it does cross-validation. So with 5 faults, if you don't give it any settings. So you will see later that that also gives slightly different results and takes longer as well. But I also made a cell that actually uses the MAPI regressor the same way as what we just computed and also what I did with Krebs. So then you give it your prefit model. So then I first train my model that I did at the top of this notebook, and I use the prefit setting so it doesn't train it anymore again. So it also doesn't do cross validation because I didn't do that. And still I can use the fit predict method. And then for MAPI, the prediction gives both the point prediction and the prediction interval in one line of code. Maybe show it. So just one array with the point prediction and one prefit prediction intervals with the interval. So then you have 2 values every time. And you can see that it's a lot slower. So it's 1.4, where for Krebs it was 0.1. It's quite a big difference. But then depends really on your use case or that's important. And you have a lot of advantages of MAPI because you can keep on extending to more different methods. So if we plot the results, so what I did here is I made a plot that gives your mean prediction and then several things on the vertical axis. So here you have all the red dots are the actual observations. So you can see those are quite scattered. Then you have this yellow dots, that is the mean prediction. And you can see that constant around it, you have your prediction interval. So actually this is what we would expect. So it behaves as we would have expected. And the amount of points that is in between the lines, oh, I plotted them, I printed them here. You can see that they also match. So they are 0.9 or at least rounded. There are 0.9 of the points of the test sets indeed in our prediction interval. So that's what we want. Because quite commonly there's also other methods and they don't, they can be biased. So it can be that it's different, but the advantage of this method is that you're sure it's gonna be correct, given that your calibration set is a representation of your test set. And then here, what I just showed that Krebs is 11 times faster. So in this plot, it might look like there's a lot of points out of the interval, but that's also the way the visualization works. Is there any questions about that? Is there anyone that ever used this before? No? Interesting. Yeah, you a little bit. I'm not surprised. okay. I assume then that no questions means you understand it. But if there's at a later moment a question, let me know. Yeah?
I have a question specifically about the
work. Okay.
You mentioned that you have used this in the context of capsules, right?
Yeah.
But for that, would we be able to assume that the covariance of usage stays constant?
Yeah.
I think that especially in the context of capsule project, that's kind of a big challenge.
Yeah, so a big problem is that if you, for a time series, you randomly select your calibration set, you get the distribution based on your whole training period. But usually the data changes over time. You have some kind of data drift. So you want to look actually at the latest, newest points. So there are several methods that do that. But then you do lose the guarantee that it's always correct because it is not a statistical guarantee anymore, but just like any model that it's, if you would have to correct, how do you say it, always, if you have a large enough calibration set, it goes towards the correct value.
Yeah. Okay, but what if the prediction interval increases? So if I want to make like the more,
The further in the future you predict. Oh, yes. That's what you mean.
The more the assumption becomes different.
Yeah, that is covered in the next part that I'm going to discuss. But it's not in this method itself, it's constant over the time frame you give it. Yeah, so it's not that you say like it's farther ahead in the future, because it also doesn't use any features. So you also don't have any information actually about that point. It's just really on the distribution of the target that you have in your data set.
We go to the presentation.
Okay. Yeah, so I already mentioned it, but I still wanted to do a small recap. There's some super nice benefits of this method. First, you said it's model agnostic, so it doesn't matter which model you already use. So you can really, for your goal that you have in your job, you can choose the model that works best for you specifically, and then add this method on top. So you're very free to do whatever you want. It just gives you extra information. Then next, I mentioned as well, so it has a statistical guarantee. So it's always, yeah, because it really uses the distribution of your data set, it will always give you the correct percentage. While most machine learning methods actually have, it's called asymptotically consistent. So if you add more data or if you add more features, it goes towards the correct value, but you're not certain that it's there. You don't need to make any assumptions on the distribution beforehand. So that's not only easier, but can also prevent mistakes because maybe your assumption is just incorrect. Then it's the disadvantages are that it's constant over your prediction set and you only have an interval instead of a distribution. So we'll go into that a little bit more. So it's quite similar to what you, to your question, like if this is a time series, I know that this point and this point have a different uncertainty. But in this method, how we applied it right now in the workshop, it will be constant. And it's not only for time series, but further in the future, I think it has a different uncertainty. It's also for any data set, because you have your machine learning model, and normally machine learning models have a huge set of features that you throw in. So you have all this data, all this knowledge about the observations. So maybe I already know that if this is solar energy, I know that at this moment there's a lot of sun forecasted, and at this moment it's very cloudy. So if a day has a clear blue sky, uncertainty is quite low because there's not a cloud accidentally drifting by at that moment. But if it's quite cloudy, maybe that minute is cloudy, but maybe 5 minutes later there's sun again. So those kind of information you would like to capture. So that's what the next part of this workshop will be about. And then it's also, if you just do this for one interval, you can repeat it as well, but keep in mind that if you look at an interval, it doesn't give you distribution. So most people will have in mind, let me stand a bit to the side. Usually you have kind of a Gaussian curve in mind, so the top one. So this interval could give something like that. So it's very likely that it's going to be around the point that you forecast, and the further you go from it, the more unlikely it gets. But it's not necessarily the case. The bottom one could be just as well a possibility of the underlying distribution. And if you want to balance the energy grid, it really matters, or you expect it to be in balance, and maybe it's not in balance. Or if you would have the bottom one, where you expect that it's not in balance, you just don't know which side. So you maybe want to prepare more for that. So in the second part, we will go into conformalized quantum regression is a different method that solves for this. So this was the first part, just the prediction interval. And here it's the second part. And you see I also in the simplification, but I also show that it's different, like the width of the interval can be different over time. And it also gives you a full distribution, not just an interval. The method is very similar. So we will go through the same steps. And then for every step, I will explain what's the difference. And what's the same? So we start with training again. Only this time we don't train a point model. We train a probabilistic model. So this is very different from the previous one because you just use a totally different model. So a very common way to do probabilistic forecasting is to use quantum regression. I will explain that method in the following slides, but you also have different models that give probabilistic forecasts. So that output the full distribution. So you can think about, you have a quantum regression forest, which uses a random forest with a set of a point. It gives you all the, all the points that it has in that prediction bucket. You have a level set, you have several neural nets that also end up with probabilistic predictions. So you really look at the different type of model categories. Does someone use a probabilistic forecast? Yeah, which model do you use?
I believe
Okay. And you used it as well? Oh yeah, Bayesian?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah, so also for Bayesian models, it works as well. So for the people that don't work with probabilistic models, I shortly explain one, but it's not the main topic of this workshop, so it's gonna be a little bit fast. So quantum regression, the very basic thing you do is you retrain the model again and again. So instead of only training one model to predict one point, I also train a model to predict the 20%. I also train a model to predict the 40%. And maybe if you say I want to have a value for every percentage, so then you train 100 models. And it's very easy to do in practice in Python because you can just, for example, like IGBM, you can just set the objective to quantile. Then you can say which quantile and it works. So you don't need to make any changes to your data or do anything difficult. So it just is included in the package. But of course, it depends on the method you're using or that's possible. And if you then set the objective to quantile, it changes the loss function. So usually what you would do is you look at the symmetrical loss function, that's if you're wrong on one side during the training, it's the same weight as when you're wrong on the other side during training. And then you get, of course, at the prediction you expect. But if you give it an asymmetrical loss function, you say if the value that I predict during training is too high, I punish more than the other way around. So if you want to do the 20%, it's okay if you're too high, but if you're too low, you have a very high loss, and the other way around. So if you want to look at the 80%, if you're too low, that's a little bit bad, but still fine. But if it's too high, I punish it a lot. So you can imagine that if I would look at 90%, it goes like this. And so it kind of tilts. It's called pinball loss, and that's because it's the shape of a pinball machine. So in a pinball machine, it goes everywhere. So that's a way to remember the name. And then if you combine all those models, you end up in your distribution. And this is what I said before, that it's, so just objective quantile and the quantile that you want to predict. So just like a few words and you predict a quantile regression. And then I'm not sure everyone was asking the same thing, but the common question I get here is like, why do we then need conformal prediction? Because it's perfect. It gives me full distribution. It changes over time. I know all the uncertainty, so I have everything we need. So why do we actually still need conformal prediction? So this is what I also mentioned in the previous section, that machine learning methods, they go towards the correct value, but they're not always that's not always the case. So quite often they can be biased, and that's, if you want to base your decision on it, it's of course a problem if your results are biased. While conformal prediction really gives the guarantee that it's on average, it's correct. But the disadvantage then was that we didn't look at any knowledge we had about the features. While quantile regression of course does, because it used the whole feature space and predicts a different quantile. So that's why this part is about calibrating your probabilistic forecast. And if you do that combined with quantile regression, it's called conformalized quantile regression. So then you can use both the advantages of both worlds, actually. So you use the statistical guarantee. So on average, it will be correct. But you also use all that knowledge that you have about the feature. So you really predict a probabilistic distribution over time. Let me drink a little bit of water and then continue. So now we're talking about distributions instead of intervals. But the calibration we're going to do it per interval of the distribution. So we're actually going to kind of make snippets for every interval, calibrate, and then repeat the whole process. So it's quite iteratively. So I will just explain one iteration and that you will repeat as many times as you want. So we did the training, we have a probabilistic forecaster. So now we can make the probabilistic forecast for our calibration set. And then if we only select one interval, this is how it will look like. So you have your forecast and two boundaries. And I can compare my actuals of the calibration set to that interval. So in this case, it can be either outside or inside. So you always compare it to the value that is the closest. And because you want to know, is the interval too wide or too narrow? So therefore, when we make the list, we don't use absolute values because this time it can go in two directions. It can be that it's too wide. It can be that it's too narrow. So we do the same thing. We again select the quantile that we want to look at on this list. So here, if my forecast was from 30 to 70%, means that here I want to look at the confidence of 50%. Because I made the forecast for that range. You can also play around with it. It also works if you have here 50% and here I do 10%, but then you're gonna put a huge correction. So the closer it's together, the better, because then you don't have to correct too much. And then if the value that comes out is positive, it means the distribution gets wider, so more uncertain. And if it's negative, the distribution will get more narrow. So this you repeat over and over again, and you use that in your forecast. So now you predict with your same model for the prediction set, and then you can, for every point of the distribution, you have a certain factor. So in this case, you see I did draw an example where it gets wider. So then there will be a list of positive points that I add for every quantile. Yes?
Does the calibration score again the same over all time?
Yeah. So the calibration is the same. So we use for any point, I use the same calibration. But because the input differs per point in time, because certain model that I have gives a different distribution per moment in time, that will be different. And that's also why you want to have, in the previous step, you want to match the interval that you're forecasting with your machine learning model and the one that you use in conformal prediction, because otherwise you do a huge calibration factor that is constant over time.
I have another question.
Yeah?
Why do we need to calibrate the calibration model as well? Like, isn't there a bit more loss?
It can be that it's not needed. Okay. You can check for it. So it can be that it matches the distribution, but in most of the cases, it's a bit biased. So then it doesn't, it's not perfectly calibrated. So the bigger your data set and the more features you have, the less relevant it is. So the more basic your feature space, the more relevant it is, because it's a higher chance that it will be a bit biased. Yeah?
Check if I understood it correctly. Would it be accurate to say that what you're doing here now is having like a conformity bound, so to speak, same as before, but instead having that around the prediction itself, we have it around the quantile bounds? Is that the gist of it? Okay.
The only thing is that, so if this are the interval you start with, they will be like around it constantly over time. So it's not that you have a bound around each one of them. It's just that, do you understand what there isn't?
The like bound around the quantile order, so to speak, they will be constant, right?
Yeah.
Like given the
yeah,
the
so I can just move this line a little bit up and I can move this line a little bit down or the other way.
Yeah.
How computation is that support?
Easy. They're not because it really looks at averages, so it doesn't take a lot of compute. It's a lot quicker than a training like a LightGPM model or something.
Okay.
So we trained it, we did the calibration. Oh, here I did draw it also a little bit. Then it looks like this. So it's like a constant line that moves upward and downward. Yeah, so in... Yeah, so what I try, it's a big simplification, but what I try to draw here is that you have your prediction, then have the interval that you predicted around it, and I move both of them a bit, little bit wider. So then the correction factor is constant over time, and just everywhere it gets a little bit wider. So now you can go to the workshop again and do the same thing. It's the second file in the workshop.
So we'll take 10 minutes.
Okay, yeah.
So let's take 10 minutes for that, and we'll get back to you. Okay?
Okay. I will continue with walking through the code because it's already 8 and I also want to have a time for you to have just a drink. André, I'm gonna come to you.
But afterwards, there's beers and lots of time to discuss statistics and data and everything you want. So here, this notebook is slightly longer, but it has the same concept. So again, we start with the input, we have our data, we split it. That's the same as in the first notebook, so I won't go over that. We choose our confidence level and we train our model. And in this case, it's I set it to quantile regression. So now it's a quantile model. And in the full notebook, I only look at one interval. So usually, of course, you're going to predict a full distribution and you want to calibrate the full distribution. But just to keep it as simple as possible, so you first understand the concept before going to something more complex, I will only look at a single interval. So the first thing we want to do is train that quantile regression model. So here I did it from 5% to 95%. And that is the starting point. Let me go to the solution file and run it. So now you will see that, let's check, yeah, I'm here. So now you will see that the interval around our prediction is not constant over time anymore. So where in the previous notebook you saw it was very stable and consistent, it now varies over time. But we also see, if we print this, that we have a 90% interval because we're looking at 5 to 95%. So we want 90% of the points to be inside that interval. But there's actually only 83%. So in this example that I made here, we see that it's biased. So it's not what we want to have. So here it's actually useful to calibrate it. It can also be that you have models where it gives you the correct thing every time you check, then you of course don't need to add any complexity and you don't have to calibrate it. So then, I added the same steps as in the previous one to first compute it ourselves, so really understand what happens, and then look at both of the packages. So what you want is you want to predict already, already your calibration set, so the lower bound and the upper bound, so you have the interval that you want to calibrate. Here I also printed it. And I can see that in the calibration set, also not 90% is in the interval. So here I looked at the test set and now I look at the calibration set. So it's useful to use this calibration set for calibrating the interval. And now comes an interesting part. Because on the slide, for me, it was quite easy to draw it. You just say, you have a line and you have some points and you compare it to each other. But now in Python, that doesn't work. Maybe someday you can just draw in something and then it's gonna, ChatGPT is gonna help us with it. But you have to write that yourself. So here you wanna have the value, the smallest arrow. So if it's above the upper line, you want the difference between the point and the upper line. But if it's below the lower line, you want the difference between the lower line and that point. Who did find the answer to that? How you write this down? What did you find?
You mean like what did I wrote?
Yeah.
It's the upper bound minus YKL, first one, and then the YKL minus the lower bound.
Yeah, exactly. So I will show it here. So you have to be careful that you have them in the correct sign. So that's, if it's higher than the upper bound, I want it to be positive. So I look at the upper bound, the calibration minus the upper bound, the second one. But if it's lower than the lower bound, I also want it to be positive. So that one is switched around. And then we take the maximum of them. So we only look at the line that it's closest to. So for example, if it's higher than the upper bound, I have the difference with the upper bound. So that's a positive value. then I have the difference within the lower bound as well, because it's also, if you look from the lower bound inside the interval, that will be a very negative value because it's the whole interval plus this part that's above. So that, if I take the max, that will just drop out and I only look at the difference with the line that's closest. Does it make sense? Yeah, see some nodding, that's good. So then we do exactly the same thing again. We make our list and we select the index we want to look at. Now I use the quantile function, but it does the same thing. So you just take a certain percentage of your list and that's the factor you're going to use for every prediction you make. So I made the matrix for that. So here I create the same dimensions, the correction factor, and you can just sum it. So you can just for every point add the correction factor. So if it's positive, it gets wider, and if it's negative, it gets more narrow, because you see that here, when I make it into two columns, I do -1 for the lowest one. I think this is something, if you really want to start using, it's nice to go through this again, that you really understand what happens. So if you use a package, of course, it's handled for you, so you don't need to, but it's nice to have this in a correct image in your mind. Otherwise, it can confuse you later. So let's run this. And now you see that after the calibration, we want 90% and we have 90%. So that's what we want. The next part, I think I'm just going to leave there for you to look at if you want to, because I also want to save some time. And it's very similar because, again, we're going to do for every time you can just train and predict, fit and predict. So it's the same syntax that you're used to. So there's not that much to see here. I can run them though to see the results. So here you see that when we only did quantile regression, we had a coverage of 84%. Well, we wanted to have 90. You can run the same notebook and then at the top change the confidence and see what it ends up to. And if we calibrate it for all of the packages, the same happens and we are at 90. That's what we want. Here below, I also linked to packages for time series specifically. So if you like, you can also always look at the time series regressor. So show that in a bit. So now in the previous slide, I showed advantages, disadvantages, but now in the second method, it was a little bit more extensive, but we solved our disadvantages. But there was one thing I kind of didn't tell you so far, because there's one extra disadvantage, but I wanted to bridge towards it. So there is an assumption. So there's no assumption on the distribution of the data, so that you don't have to do, but there is the assumption that the time series data is exchangeable. So if we look at time series data, you assume that you can exchange it freely over time, which is actually almost never the case. So also I did draw it like, I can clearly see that points here have a different distribution than points there. So there's some data drift happening, and that's quite common. You always want to look, you value your recent observations more than observations longer in the past. So quite often you use, for example, a larger weight for the samples that are more recent. So the same holds for this method. You have just packages installed, for example, the maybe time series regressor, that do add more weight to the recent one. The only disadvantage then is that it becomes asymptotical consistent instead of always having the guarantee. But if you're dealing with time series, that's still the best to look at, because you do want to make the best forecast you know at this moment of time. So that was it. It's almost time to have a little bit of drinks and process all this information. So the main things I want to take you let you take home is that it is a statistical guarantee, which is super nice because you know it's correct based on your data. You can make it conditional if you use calibrating a probabilistic forecast. And we use it also to accelerate the renewable energy transition. You can use it for any use case, but it's also used for this. And then it's a topic that's coming up, so maybe in the future you will see it more and more. So this is the Google trends over time. So you can really see that the start of 2022, it starts to rise. I'm very curious what's going to happen. There's a lot of new developments. If you, for example, look at the maybe package, there's new things added all the time. So if you like this topic and you want to stay up to date, the awesome conformal prediction repository is a good place to follow. It has a lot of information. There's really so much you cannot look at it all. This presentation is also in that repository, actually. So you can find it there as well. And it's also not a coincidence that it starts at the start of 2022. So this trend and this repository match quite nicely. So it's a really a place that almost everyone goes to. It's made by someone that also just wrote a book. If you want to have a look after the workshop, I have it as well. It was released end of December, so I have it for a bit more than a week now. So, oh yeah, of course. And I'm not sure they see it, but I think so.
Yes.
Yep. Thanks. So if you read it now, you're really up to date since it's just out here in a week. Thank you all very much for coming. Feel free to stay and have a drink and chat. Always love chatting about everything with Forecast. You can also follow me on LinkedIn. I'm actually writing a blog. So somewhere coming week, most likely I will publish it. It's the same topic. So if you want to read again what we discussed, if you follow me, you will see the blog come by and you can see a summary.
And sorry for hijacking. I will do two announcements and then we will stop streaming part. And then it's time for you to relax, chat, have some drinks and talk to Inge, of course, and the rest of your colleagues. So literally what's next? Save the date. The next R event will take place at the 28th of February, which is a really interesting date. I couldn't give you the topic yet, but I would say we fly a person from Paris office of Hugging Face. So more information coming later. So this 28th of December, you see, 28th of February. And another one, which is a really interesting event. And by the way, if you want to contribute to MAPI or to CREPES, at the 23rd of March, we running Python open source sprints with a contribution to different libraries. The major focus, of course, non-focus libraries such as Pandas and the rest. We are going to look for mentors as well, those who have some experience contributing to open source and just want to guide some people. So we're going to see how many libraries we're going to cover. On the list, there are some non-focus libraries as well, such as FastAPI, for example. So take a look. It's a Saturday, which is slightly unusual for us. Usually, like those who attend our events, you know, it's from Tuesday to Thursday in the evening. It's Saturday because it's half of the day. And it's be hosted just really next to this building. It will be hosted by Picnic. So once again, if you wanted to help to contribute to conformal predictions to mapping purpose, I guess they would be also really curious to get contributions. And it's not only about writing code. It could be documentation. It could be basic tests, whatever you're looking for. So thanks about this part. We are closing the streaming part now. All these materials also is available. So the video record is available. So when you're home at your normal pace, you can just rewatch back this video. We're gonna add the timestamps to it. So to make sure that they point you to the right parts of it. So thanks again, Inge. And just in case, the PyLadies is Amsterdam, one of the organizers, if you're just wondering who am I, why I'm talking. And there is Nancy. Nancy, if you can raise your hand. This Nancy is the another PyLadies is Amsterdam organizer. Just for you to know about us. Thanks a lot. So I'm closing the stream now. So yeah. Goodbye, those who watched us online. Thanks for asking questions and answering questions as well. So yeah, the streaming part is closed.
Thank you very much. Thanks.